Before starting this course on career counseling, it is extremely important to understand why you should take your career choice seriously. In this video, we will help you understand the importance of making the right career choice for yourself. So, why is your career choice so important? It is important because it determines a lot of things in your life, including number 1, quality of life. Your career choice plays a huge role in deciding where you live, how flexible your life is, and the kinds of things you are able to do in your free time. Number 2, identity. Ask any elder person about their career and they will tell you about it as a part of their identity. They'll say something like, "I am a journalist," instead of, "I report news." Notice how everybody asks you, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" and not, "What do you want to do when you grow up?" This shows that your career choice shapes your identity. Number 3, impact. Every human life touches thousands of other lives in so many different ways. If you select any 60-year-old person who is about to retire, take a time machine, find him as an infant, throw that infant into trash, and then come back to the present day, you'll find that a countless number of things around you have changed. So whatever career you choose, the world will be affected by it. Anything that determines your quality of life, your identity, and the impact that you make should be taken very seriously. And that includes your career choice also. So we hope that this short video could help you understand the importance of making the right career choice. Having done that, we will now move forward to start our career counseling course. We are pretty excited and we hope you are too. So, let's begin. See you.
Welcome everyone, welcome to day 41 of Pro Bono's live podcast. Firstly, sabko swagat hai, the audience members. Anita ji, as always, is here. Shikha ji is also here. Firstly, welcome Aditya, Mr. Sen. And of course, aaj ka guest hai Rajiv Sodhi ji, who is the managing director and founder of Enable IT. So firstly, thank you so much, sir, for taking time to speak with us. Welcome to our podcast. Toh main introduce kar leta hoon aapko. Mr. Rajiv is the Managing Director and Founder of Enable IT. Under his leadership, the company has experienced significant growth in a very short period of time, having large marquee customers in USA and India. The company just opened a new office in USA and has executed partnership arrangements with Carnegie Mellon University, USA and IIT Delhi. His company works on developing platforms for machine learning and artificial intelligence, especially in facial recognition and predictive analytics using deep neural networks. It also provides advisory and program management services in digital transformation, automation and machine learning, operational efficiency, product and services portfolio, and market expansion, acquisition integration. There's a whole list of things here. He has been consulting for over 15 years across USA, Europe, Asia, Pacific, and Middle East with organizations such as the World Bank, UNDP, Booz Allen, ENY, BCG, and McKinsey on strategic assignments. He has 38 years of IT experience, of which 10 years have been spent in 8 countries overseas. He is a graduate in Electrical and Electronics Engineering from BITS Pilani and an MBA in Marketing from Western International University. He is also among the first CQAs from Quality Assurance Institute, USA. He has been a member of IEEE and American Management Association. He is a major donor and past president of the Rotary Club of New Delhi and an active participant in their work in social development. He maintains a personal blog called www.rajivsodhi.com where he writes about technology application in business. Wow, that was a mouthful. Firstly, again, Rajiv ji, thank you so much for taking time to speak with us. Welcome. मैंने जो बोला उसके अलावा वॉट एवर लिटिल बिट आई थिंक इज लेफ्ट फ्रॉम वॉट एवर आई सेड, अगर आप इंट्रोड्यूस कर सकते हो इन योर ओन वर्ड्स एंड एड्रेस योर ऑडियंस ओवर टू यू. थैंक यू सो मच.
Thank you and thank you audience. It's a pleasure for me to be here at Pro Bono. You have been very gracious in my introduction, so I don't want to take more time and would like to give more time in interacting with you and you know, helping answer any questions, or of course they are only my opinion and you have to take it with a pinch of salt and look at it as if it is my opinion and not a public opinion. So I'd like to you know, share my experience, my opinion, and also any guidance from my point of view, and you can make the best decisions for yourself. Thank you.
Great. तो पहले आपका जर्नी जानना चाहेंगे. Firstly, your journey from, you know, working in different organizations, and then finally starting your own startup after nearly 35 years of experience. So how has your journey been working at some other institute, and then your journey to starting your own startup?
So I have only worked in two companies in all my life, so it's not been a very you know, large journey in multiple companies. So I started with TCS in 1981, and that was also quite coincidental because I graduated, actually I passed my school in 76, and then so journey has been quite I would say varied. So I initially wanted to be a sports person. I in school played table tennis at sub junior. We did pretty well. My colleagues or friends won the Delhi state tournament. Then when I became in senior school, it was 12th at that time, it was 11th higher secondary, so 9th, 10th, 11th. So I played cricket and then I played for the North Zone. Then I was counseled ki sports mein passion nahi hai, so you have to study. So I had to change my direction from table tennis to cricket, and then I joined the engineering college, Wits Pilani, which was also a very tough journey because that was a unique educational institution where they didn't tell you what subject you are joining. So you had to actually win your degree along the way. So after first year, they separated. They took unassigned people, 400 people in a year. And then based on your performance, you could choose between science and engineering as one stream and arts and as other stream. Then after second year, the science and engineering became separated. After third year, you got to know which engineering you are doing. So it was a very tough life because it was a relative system. So I learned through that experience. And even then, after Wits Pilani, I had no intention of immediately working. So I got admission in US in master's in one program and PhD in another program. And in 81, there was some problem with the political problem. And I was late in application for my visa, US visa, and got rejected. So TCS had offered me a job about a year before passing. That time they used to come and interview you in final years. And when I got rejected, I applied again 2-3 times. I got rejected. Then I joined TCS in August. There are other people joined in July. So it was quite by coincidence that I joined TCS. But then I lived with them and worked with them for 16 years. And I had multiple types of jobs in TCS. So everything that you could do in a company, I did that. So from technical work to sales work to managing to opening new offices to doing some legal work, doing some counseling for the people who would come to my region as fresh under me. And so I did that in 97, working in so many different countries, so many different cultures. So I was not short of variety of experience. And then the TCS head office was in Bombay, and I liked Delhi as a city. And the company that was in Delhi as a headquartered IT company was HCL. And at that time, HCL wanted to start a software company. They were into hardware, which was an HCL info system. And they said, and some of our ex-HR heads had joined HCL. So they called me and said, why don't you join us? So I joined again HCL, which was again, so TCS was very small when I joined in 81. We bought 200 people, 4 crores revenue, 50 lakhs profit in 81. We were just a part of Tata Sons at that time. We were an incubator of Tata Sons, an experimental organization. There was Tata Financial Services, there was Tata Economic Consultancy Services, there was Tata Consultancy Services. There are a lot of these things, and some of those experiments will do well, some would fail. So I joined at that time. And similarly, when HCL came in 97, I shifted to HCL. It was also a very small company. We had 60 million revenue, 6 million profit, 200 people, headquartered out of Gurgaon at that time as a software company. The mothership, HCL Infosystem, was pretty large. And now I think after 20 years with HCL, we have become the mothership, and the parent has become much smaller. So it's TCS is now a $20 billion company, and HCL is $8 billion, going to $10 billion, I think. They're clocking now. So the journey has been very good. And I have got, even in HCL, as a startup, you have to do everything. So you have to be the HR, you have to be the finance, you have to be the legal, you have to be the sales, you have to be operations, you have to recruit. So that gave me a whole around experience. And then when I retired in 2017, I thought I should do something interesting. And I was consulting as to CXOs. And for a year and a half I did. And since the last 2 years of HCL were in AI ML, working with MIT, CMU, UC Berkeley, Stanford, and then there were 4 leading universities in Europe. I was consulting with companies around operational efficiency, automation. So I was last chief competitive officer of HCL. So I had to do automation, I had to do the process efficiency, everything. So I consulted in the same way. And when it came to AI ML, the companies that I was consulting with, they said that they don't have the basic skills of the people to grasp and create applications around the concepts that I was explaining. Even in HCL, we had to send at least 50 students to CMU for training, though they were software engineers for many, many years. So they had to learn AI ML specific to what products they were building. So that was not possible with these companies. So they said, can you make platforms? And we'll subscribe to those platforms. So I started and switched. And nearest, I being from Delhi, I went to IIT Delhi and pitched that I want to start an AI ML platform practice. And there was a big, more than 300 companies that applied to do various things. There were only 15 incubators in IIT Delhi. And we had to compete very hard. And there was a Senate committee that received all the presentations and looked at the business plan, looked at the people, and then they shortlisted us. And we have been doing since then, and we have been pretty successful. And now in COVID times also, we have adapted to what is demanded in the country. So we are addressing some solutions around COVID, which I can explain to you if you are interested. But that's been my journey. So we are trying to adapt to the situation, the times, the technology, the business propositions, the markets, everything. So if you are adaptive, then you will survive. That's the Darwinian principle of evolution. That if you cannot adapt, then you will not survive. So that's how I have been. So I'm probably one of the oldest IT people still active. So that has been my journey.
Thank you so much. Enable IT. So how did that come to be? And if you can explain what exactly it is that you guys do, and what's the, and I think Aditya and you were discussing before the call that you both registered the company at around the same time, in the same month, you would say, January 2018?
Yes, that's right.
So how much have you grown? I think clearly it says, the company has grown a lot. So aapka journey, if you can explain,
So I don't know whether I should share the numbers. It's a public data. You can look at in MCA site. But we work with companies in the US. We've worked with some companies in India. We have recently won an order from Singapore. And again, we have a partner in the US, so there are other partners in India. So we are also working to our partners. So it is our philosophy is that we are not going to, we are going to focus on things which are in demand. And what I was talking to Aditya is that in every time when you have a product or a service to sell, you can, your product or service decides your growth. So there is a very nice book by people in McKinsey who have researched for 30 years, and they have said that if you look at your growth in a company, that growth depends on the biggest contributor is the product and service that you are selling. The next biggest contributor is your capability and your you know, the skills and your ability to build that. The third biggest contributor is your partnerships and ecosystem, and the fourth is your operational efficiency, etc. In the partnership and ecosystem also, you can do by partnership, you can do by acquisition. So these are the four levers of growth which every company has to exercise, and how you exercise these levers of growth decide where you are. For example, in the same business, some companies are doing extremely well and some companies are challenged. If you look at McDonald's is doing very well, but Burger King was up for sale. Or if you look at, you know, Arcom has not done very well and Bharti Airtel and has come up and Jio has done something in the same space. So you don't have to be very broad and you don't have to have many products. So the companies which are very large, they also focus on a small set of products and services, but they excel and they create such demand that their growth is the driver. For example, Coke has just a few Coke they were selling, or McDonald's selling burgers. They may have expanded the menu, but they're not doing too many things. Or if you are in Apple, I mean, they came with iPhone, or before that they came with iPod. These are two product companies, and then now iWatch and things like that. So you don't have to do too many things, or you don't have to be very diverse. You have to choose your product and you have to create some kind of a pull for your product. So if you create a pull for your product, then the customers will want to buy and your product need not be perfected. So when the cell phones, for example, were launched, I remember the first cell phone I was using, you had to hold it in your hand and you couldn't put it in your pocket and the battery would last only half an hour. And it would cost 15 rupees a minute to make a call. But and the calls would drop and things like that. So it was not as good as a landline, which was more reliable. But there was a pull. It gave you certain mobility and a certain functionality, and you could take it anywhere, you could call from anywhere. So those are the things that define what product and service. And if you are unique in the market, or if you catch the wave and you swim with the wave, you can be much faster. So that's a strategy that we try to follow in Naval IT in picking up AI ML platforms. And in that, we have just picked up right now computer vision. And in computer vision, we have just picked up facial recognition. And predictive analytics is an associate of it, which we offer to markets. And there's a huge demand or pent-up demand, or it's in a growth stage. And everybody is saying that the whole world will shift to AI ML-based platforms because the information will be, there'll be so much information overload that it'll be almost impossible for a human to analyze all the information and then make a decision. So they will have to have some tools, their assistants to take proactive actions, and only in things which are out of the line or exceptions will come to human for a decision. So the level of working of a human will become more sophisticated or more challenging, and at a higher level of decision making and interaction, and the mundane work will be taken up by these kind of things. And it is already seen in a lot of industries. So when the industrial tools have come, the people no longer plow their own fields. They have got equipment to do it, which they operate. So efficiencies improve. People don't get out of jobs because of this, but certainly the quality of life improves, the comforts improve, and people get to do more complex and sophisticated things, which is what is the human nature. They get bored with mundane very soon and they try to find alternate options. So that's what it is.
That you talked about facial recognition is one of the major things that you do. So firstly, if you could talk about the scope of facial recognition, be it social media, be it security systems, or the popular thing that is trending on the internet is the deep fakes.
Yeah.
So if you could talk about the scope and the future of facial recognition as
well. So I think, so let me explain to you that biometric based recognition is not new. You know that fingerprint based access control is there already. You have iris based recognition was there at the airports and other places. But these systems are different than what we have built. So we are trying to build something more. So these systems require physical contact. For example, you have to swipe your finger on a device to, or you have to look inside a device very closely to have an iris-based recognition. Or if you have, talking about a little older technology, you have to do either use swipe card or access card, or you have to carry some card for your ID. Now, what we are saying is that, and there are so many cards, there's a PAN card, there is a Aadhaar card, there is a tax card, there is so many things. So what we have thought is that a human face has to be also have a signature. And just like a fingerprint, there is there, a human face also has a signature. And if we can, and AI, ML, or artificial intelligence is basically a human senses being replicated by a computer. So vision-based things that you do, can the computer do that? So what we did was that we said that we will be able to recognize a person by his face. That is the first parameter. Second is that we want to recognize in a live environment, a moving person. So right now, if you go and stand in front of a booth or a kiosk, that's the way of recognition. Even people who are doing facial recognition, you have to show your face to an iPad or go in a booth and then go in close proximity. And it clicks a picture of you and sends the picture to a cloud, and then gets the recognition from one of the traditional recognition engines, which are Google and Amazon's and all. They have these standard things and they return a result. So second thing we said is that we'll recognize a live person. So as we are speaking, if I move back and as I'm coming, so I will be recognized from far. I will be recognized as I'm moving. I'll be recognized from my side view if I'm looking up, or if I'm without my glasses, with my glasses, I get a new haircut. I shave my beard, I shave my mustache. The system should be able to recognize me, because that's how the human works, right? If you clean, if you shave yourself, I will still recognize you, right? So that is the second thing that is our differentiator. Third thing that we said is that we will be able to do this whole processing on an edge device. So we don't need internet. So I can recognize with a standalone machine. A human is a standalone machine. A human doesn't send information to internet and gets a feedback from the cloud to say who is the person. It just looks at recall of his memory from inside his brain or wherever the memory is storing. So we are working on edge computers, which is a standalone laptop, desktop, or any device, phone, or anything that itself has everything to solve the problem. So now, if we have a system like that, and once we recognize a person, what do? We display the name on the screen, just like in my screen, there is Rajiv Sodhi is coming on the bottom. But in my system, Rajiv Sodhi will come in the, my box will be made on my face, and it will say Rajiv Sodhi. And if I go a bit back or behind, or as I'm walking, the box will travel and will always cover my face. And if there are 10 people standing, my software will also recognize all the 10, and all the 10 will be tracked live. And what does it do? It does a convenience of, so various applications of this. The easiest one is attendance. Now, if I have an industry where, let's say you have a manufacturing industry, there are 1,000 shift workers coming in every day and signing attendance. Now, if they do fingerprinting or if they do swipe cards, they have to do one by one. We have 1,000 people even enter the factory may require at least half an hour or an hour. So I just put a camera in front of the main gate, and everybody who passes the camera, attendance is registered. You don't have to do anything. You have to just look at the camera and walk, and you walk naturally. So it is convenience. And I also can walk similarly when I walk out. My exit is recorded, so day's attendance is recorded. Now apply this, so the same thing for access control. So, you know, when the person is recognized, my system can trigger the door opening or door closing or access control. Then I can do surveillance. So there are applications where even within a company, some people are authorized to do some things. So for example, if we are working with an oil company and they have oil storage tanks, they are saying that only a few named employees can go to the storage tanks and others can only work in their offices. So you can say whose face opens which door and where is he allowed to go. So that is access control. Then surveillance, so law and order. For example, if there are, so my software can also recognize from videos, just like live camera, if there's a recorded video, I can extract the faces from the video. I can say who all is present. And then those, I can register them, make signatures, and I can recognize them from wherever they are. As long as the camera feed is available to me, I can call out the people that are in my database. So surveillance is another use case. An ATM, for example, in a bank, if you go and withdraw your money, you have to swipe your card or you have to do a fingerprint. If you face the ATM, there's already a camera because it's recording who is accessing the ATM. And if you are recognized and you allow the bank to allow the ATM to recognize you, and then you just withdraw the money. Now, how it has become more relevant is in COVID-19 times, because COVID transmission happens by contact. So if you can do these access control and attendance and even ATM operation or retail point of sale machine operation without contact, so the number of contacts will be reduced, and therefore you can't transmit the virus from even if you're affected. Then I have proposed that I can add a thermal camera to my recognition engine, and while you are walking in, besides recognizing you, it can also take your temperature and say if you are within the temperature range, then you should be allowed, and automatic detection like that. So these are the things which are being pulled. These are everybody wants. So there's a shortage of such things, and everybody wants such things. Now, other applications which I had planned without COVID times is that I can, for example, if a retail store took my application, or a restaurant took my application, or a quick service restaurant took my application, and the quick service restaurant was in a mall, and I point the camera outside my store, and I see the people walking by, and I know that there is a customer who's registered, my customer, and he's walking by, and I can send him an SMS, yeah, please, I have this special offer for you, and please come and buy this chai or whatever coffee you want or things like that. So that's a loyalty system. Or if you walked in a hotel and the manager greeted you by person name, you may not be a very famous personality, but you will get a hi that you know the person, because the recognition doesn't have to, you don't know that you're recognized, you're just, the camera is watching you and it can say that so-and-so person has come by name and history. And so loyalty programs can be run with that. Access control, we have requests for manufacturing lines. So my computer vision software can see whether there are any cracks in the product, or if you are manufacturing shoes or slippers, your color is matching, there's no stitching has come out. So whatever the human vision does, the computer can do the same thing. And then we can do a lot of analytics around it to say, if I say that this person was in this camera at this time and this camera at this time or connected to a GPS, then I can say that I can do surveillance. I can, if there are any suspicious people, like for example, in law and order, you have these surveillance cameras on the street and there's a incident gets recorded. Now, if I get that video of that incident, I can extract the face and I can run it against a database to say whether that person is found in any other database or any other video. So humans don't have to look at the video. They can just say that this person was found in these videos, these places at these times. So very quick reconnaissance, et cetera, can be done. We were approached by Navy Coast Guard they have, because of the infiltration that happened in the past by boats in Bombay, and there was this Bombay incident of all the, the terrorist incident 2611 that we call. They have issued ID cards to all the fishermen on the coast, and they have to physically validate that the IDs are actually the same people who live there. If the Coast Guard was on their boat and the fishermen are on their boat, so if they just point the camera at the boat of the fishermen and a zoom camera and get a face, then they know who all are there on the boat, and they don't need to mount the boat, and the surveillance will be very effective. So there are hundreds and thousands of use cases, very generic application, and I can connect this recognition to any backend of the system, whether it's you want to make an order of this, you want to log attendance, you want to pay payroll for variable pay, daily workers, whatever you want to do. So it connects to the backend. I'm not building any application. So this is what I choose to do. And over a period of time, I will add speech and text to this speech processing. So all the human senses, the speech is a sense. So the speech, we speak one language, but my system may speak 9-10 languages, may translate from each other with context. It may analyze written handwriting with context, just like a human does, and do whatever action. Already there is a sense of the prediction or the intuition of a person. So intuition of a human is the predictive analytics that we do with deep neural networks. And then the full robotics, if you add the physical motion and put it in a robo, then you can get some kind of a robot to do something. So the technology is not that advanced that it can even replace a child now, because a child can do many more functions than this machine can do, only one function and a specific problem at a time. So that is where the current state of technology is, but it is going to grow very fast. It's going to be adopted and it's going to be very, very useful for future is what I feel. And that's why I started this company and Nibble IT.
Great. And what you talked about, in the future where facial recognition would be necessary after COVID-19, or as Mr. Sen puts it, from life 2.0. So yes. I am excited for that conversation. Lekin Mr. Sen ka aaj nahi hai to make up for Aditya's deal yesterday. So firstly, I'll move directly to Aditya. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Saman, and thank you so much to Rajiv sir for being with us today. And thank you so much to the audience members for being with us. So I would like to read out some audience comments first, because I think a lot of love is coming towards us. So Chaudhary Akash Singh says, thank you for motivating us. Thank you so much, Akash. Mr. Raja Gopalan Rangarajan, who is the vice principal of DTEA, one of the DTEA schools, Delhi Tamil Education Association, says, good evening to all. Thanks for arranging sessions every day. And thank you to people like you, sir, who come on to this session every day and make it worth conducting. Anita ji says, welcome, sir. Great. Krishna says, good evening, everyone. Okay. So these are a bit old comments. And now I'll come to the audience questions. So, sir, and many of the audience questions, since they kind of, merge with what I wanted to ask you, so I'll kind of merge them with that. Since, in the beginning of your address, you told us that adaptation is key. And I think there can be no better example than you. We were also talking about this before the call, that you have adapted very well to the changing technology, and it has massively changed from that time to now. So in line with this, Anita ji asks, I have read that all the jobs would be replaced in the future by automation, AI, and machine learning, except creative thinking and leadership jobs. Is it true? If yes, how much time will it take? And I'll like to club another question with this. Sir, what is the basic skills that keeps you learning and updating? What is the role of management skills in this? So, sir, there are two questions broadly. One is that the role of AI in replacing jobs of today and maybe, you know, creating new jobs tomorrow. What's your take on that? And how do you keep updating yourself in these changing times?
So first of all, I want to make it very clear that AI is never going to replace a human being. And it is not going to replace any jobs. And I've been hearing this for the last 40 years. When I joined in this field in the early 80s, it was said that humans are going to replace the accountants, the banks will become tellerless and everything. But if you look at it now, there are more bank branches and more banks after the computers have been introduced, and there are ATMs coming. I heard that there will be no tellers, but there's nothing that replaces personalized banking. So banks have found a way that relationship managers come to you, the bank comes to you, then you're going to the bank and standing in queues and filling manual registers. So that's on banking. But even if I take any agricultural industry or any other industry, there has been, even in industrial revolution, when the machines came, it was said that human beings will no longer be required. But machines came, big factories came, and they were producing cars, and there were a lot of workers, assembly line workers required. It's just that your job profile changes, and it is never that a human becomes redundant, and human is the most adaptive machine. And therefore, it will adapt to any circumstance, anywhere. So that's the first answer, that irrespective of whatever happens in AI, however it must develop, a human will never be replaced. But you have your job that you will do will change. So you have to therefore know. The second part of the question is that what kind of you have to learn the things that you do in AI, how much you will have to learn. So I would like to again answer it in this way, that when you use a product, I mean, you have been using a telephone, now you use smartphones, how much of technology you know to which goes into a smartphone to use a smartphone? So the more sophisticated the machines are from inside, the more easier they are to use from outside. So today, for example, I know that even any farmer friends, they use smartphones because there is a whole system that connects with them in their own language with SMS, etc., to say, okay, what crop they can grow based on their soil conditions, weather patterns, what fertilizer they have to sow, and every step of the way they are given guidance that to improve the crop yield, this is what you have to do. Now, this never happened 50 years ago or 40 years ago or even 10 years ago. But today, even a farmer who is not if he does not read or write, then the phone speaks to him. So the SMS, instead of coming as an SMS, comes as a call. And the farmer can also call an 800 number and ask his question to the Council of Agricultural Requests. We call it Krishi Vikas KVKs, Krishi Vikas Kendras, and there are Krishi Vikas field officers who go and connect with the farmers. And every farm person is connected and is getting an advice, and the yield of the crop has improved multiple times in the last many years because of this intervention. Second example I would like to take is that of even a household help or a home worker or any worker anywhere is much more educated. If you have a question, you can Google it, and you can Google in your own language, and you will get an answer. How to handle COVID, what treatments are happening, what is happening in US, what is happening in research in this area and that area. And I would say that almost everybody, even children, are so educated and much more educated and informed. If you want to learn something, you can learn online. If you have a query, you get very easy answers. In our time, we had to go through encyclopedias and we had to go through books to get answers. We would go to libraries, reference books, and try to get some answers or talk to some experts. There wasn't even an email available to us to write. But are we out of jobs? The number of the population has grown from about 2 billion in 1940 to about 7 billion now in current form. And the technology in every field has advanced, whether it is industrial automation, whether it is mechanics, whether it's chemical, or it is in even in movies. If you take the sophistication in movies, if you look at old movies, I mean, you can now know that they were edited and they could not do very sophisticated kind of scenes and bring those kind of fight scenes and war scenes and all those things. So every field is so advanced and it is so entertaining. And nowadays, if you look at some old movies, I was looking at Ramayan covered on the television the other day, and the print is so bad. And now you have those high definition televisions and you feel ki aise movie dekhte the. So what I mean is that the advancement in technology will create more opportunities than the humans can handle. The life will be much better. The average lifespan of a person was about 45, 50 when we gained independence, and now it is 72 in India. And maybe it will be 100 years very soon, another 10, 15 years. Medical science is so advanced, but still the doctors are in less supply. The medical equipment is in less supply. You take any field. Tell me in one field where we have more people. I will take a humble profession like a car driver. I mean, there's a shortage of drivers because you need couriers, you need transportation, you need supply chain. Now we have Uber and Ola, and I mean, it's very difficult. And I think the drivers earn as much as a entry-level engineer today. So it is not that in our days the professions were very limited. It was just you had to be an engineer, a doctor, or a chartered accountant, or a lawyer. And then the players became rich much later. In my time, I had an option to play games, and that was not a good profession to take at that time. But today, I mean, the players are making much more than anybody else. So the entertainers are making much more than anybody else. The painters are making much more than anybody else. And what was happening earlier versus what you are doing today, the science and the performance had advanced, even if you take athletics. I mean, earlier the best runner 100 meters would have been 14 seconds or 12 seconds and then 11 seconds and 10 seconds and 9 seconds. And now you have so many people who have broken the 9 seconds record. So is it because they have technical support? They have got professionally, they are given the advice on their diet, on what muscles are exercised when they are running are different from the muscles that they are exercised. When they are running 400 meters to 100 meters, it is so sophisticated. You think the knowledge will end? The knowledge is going to grow and grow, and there will be hardly what I studied. Maybe you may have to study only a fraction of that. But the depth that I studied was very superficial, and you may have to study 10 times the depth of that based on what you want to do. So that is how I see the world growing. So that's the answer to basically how do you adapt yourself. You have to keep on watching where the world is going and unlearning what you don't need and learn things that you need. Now, to drive a car, I don't need to understand how the car is made. Perhaps earlier when the first set of drivers had to know how the car works also. It's the same way as today the astronauts have to be able to fix any engineering problem if they go in space. But tomorrow, if space travel becomes commercial, you are just a passenger, like sitting in a plane. and you don't need to know anything about space technology. So that is how it will be. So any question I missed answering, Aditya?
No, sir. I think we have answers both the questions. So as far as the opinion on AI finishing up jobs of the future or taking up our jobs, I think as you told, the knowledge base will also increase and we'll learn how to deal with AI the way we learned how to deal with the Industrial Revolution. That's your opinion on it as far as I could understand. And secondly is regarding the adaptation. So I think we cannot have a bigger example than you with us to talk about adaptation. You know, you have seen very low memory devices and programmed on them versus now when we have no, I think there are still barriers of memory, obviously, but they have like multifoldedly increased, I think. And now obviously we have machine learning terms like IoT, blockchain coming in. I think you have adapted very well to have a company right now which is serving people in machine learning and artificial intelligence and face recognition. So Krishna says, great explanation, sir, while you were explaining this thing. So we have another question from the audience, and this one is a long one, so I'll read it out. Mr. Rajagopalan Nangarajan says, sir, as you simply say, you played tennis, cricket, then you were in TCS. The focus on what you were doing must be amazingly sharper at the time. As a teacher by profession, I see many of the students going without any focus on what little they do. Is still population and poverty that is unable to reach the basic needs a problem for the country, which deprives the focus platform for students and particularly those attending the government schools? Can you throw some light on this from your experience?
So I think I would like to answer it in many ways. The first I would like to answer is that the illiteracy is reducing in India. And there's a huge amount of focus to make India fully literate by a certain time frame, which may be exceeded. So there are NGOs, including my NGO, which I work for, Rotary. They have initiative around illiteracy removal. It's both adult illiteracy as well as children illiteracy. And I will decide that, and I'll explain that illiteracy a little later. There's a huge effort from the government of India, which is the right to education. So everybody has to be mandatorily educated. Now, and up to class six, and government provides if you cannot afford. And the government is also focused hugely on smart technologies. So if you look at least in Delhi and many of the other UP and other states, I know at least another NGO that I'm aware of, which our past CEO of HCL started, Sampark Foundation. They're also into child education. And there are many, 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 and they are using technology, frugal means to educate a child, which doesn't cost too much. And also the affordability of technology is increasing. So today you can get a smartphone for less than a minimum wage monthly salary of a mandated monthly minimum wage salary in India. So if you are working, then there's a minimum wage mandated by the government of India. So that's the level, and it's going to become even cheaper. So that is, today, if you look at internet or Google search, the governments are talking about free internet for certain hours in even panchayats, village panchayats, or in semi-rural areas, rural areas, urban areas, everywhere, railway stations. And already, I mean, so I think the difference between a private school and a government school is reducing, and the whole thing is flattening. The same thing I would apply for a big company and a small company startup. Today, I don't find myself in any disadvantage in competing with a mega organization, provided I am competing in my space. So in the same sense, for example, large organizations like ACS, Accenture has signed up with startups, including my company, to say that if we were to leverage your technology, then we will also, partner with you, take your piece and then plug it into a bigger solution. So I find it very, very encouraging. In the past, they would say that, okay, I will do it myself and we don't need any partners. So there's a realization that all four things are needed, which I said in the beginning. You have our products and services, you have to have the partnership ecosystem, you have to have the operational efficiency, and you have to have the mergers and acquisitions strategy. So all four levers, everybody is exercising, everybody has become more stuff smart. The information that is no longer, I would say, a differentiator, because information is freely, easily available. Today, if I want to read anything, it's available to me almost free or at very low cost. And a large company, and I can spend the same amount of time. Now, the difference is in what I do with that information and how do I leverage it to make a solution and an advantage to myself. So I was seeking, I see every morning and evening, I see the US opening of how they are handling COVID situation. And in India, I see the Delhi morning, what India does in COVID situation. And there are so many examples. So I saw a person who's a mechanical engineer student. So he has, what he has done in 6 weeks of, lockdown, he has made an electronic bicycle. So he has connected a motor to it and a battery to it. And now he has a 6,000 rupee electric rechargeable bicycle. He has made it. And he has, another person has made a drone. And they are using the time. Somebody is doing. So they are using their time creatively and their knowledge creatively and their experience creatively. So you have to find what is in demand and who will, and you can produce it. You don't have to be misuse of that time also. Like, you cannot black market your products because they are in demand. You have to still be reasonable. You have to make reasonable profit. You scale your operation, you sell your things. You also say that these are the defects currently I have, but these are the constraints under which you operate, and later on I will fix them or I will make it more sophisticated, because these are emerging things. So in every field of operation, there are opportunities, and you can leverage these opportunities and you can use them in any time. And humans are so adaptive. I'm looking at in my industry, which is the IT industry, there was a big no-no that you couldn't take work home because there's a client data, there's a client system is being accessed. And overnight, with the lockdown, 80% of the people are working from home. And that's the fastest change you can operate. Even we are talking on this, Zoom call, and we are connected. We don't no longer have to have a physical presence. And all of you are listening. And all of you are able to afford what you are listening. And you're able to interact, you're able to. So I think the large companies and small companies' difference has flattened. The rich and poor difference has flattened. The affordability, the knowledge available has flattened. The knowledge is even available in the language of your choice. So if something is written in English and you are reading some other language, you can ask the Google to translate it for you, and that page appears in your language. If you can't read that language, you can ask the Google to speak it for you. It will speak it for you in your language, to make you understand what you are. So there is all these are convenience things. And I think this with emerging technology, there will be an opportunity. And some of the leaders that you see today have also come from very humble backgrounds. I mean, I've also not had a very, kind of rich background. So, but we have all, we find that the opportunities are equally there for everybody from any strata of life in any region, in any language, and you have to take advantage of that.
Thank you so much, sir. So as I think we can all draw, access is increasing And so there's no gatekeeper these days to any access. So I think, yeah, that's a very good leveling field. I think it's leveling the playing field for everyone. And the differences there of the mindset, I think that will change eventually, you know, with the efforts being put in by the people at the center, like the people themselves, the students themselves, and obviously the teachers of our country. I think this divide will eventually, as you say, flatten out. And obviously we have the internet, which is the greatest power, I think, in anyone's hands, thanks to, you can call it Jio, or you can call it, you know, the overall lowering the prices of the data packs. Now everyone has access to the internet. So back in 2017, when I used to go to villages to conduct career guidance sessions, I could never see a mobile in the hand of a child, you know, who is studying in probably 9th or class 12th. But and just within 2 years, like from 2019, I started to see that the penetration of the mobile phone with an internet connection was deep into the very interiors of India, somewhere like a Jammu or a Kashmir, in fact. Or let's say, you know, interiors of Rajasthan, like proper villages, desert areas, they have their mobile phones with an internet connection. The internet is not that good, maybe, but at least they had one. So I think, yeah, this will definitely level the playing field in the future. It cannot be expected immediately. With this amazing positive thought, I would like to transfer to the star host of Pro Bono. I think we have already given him very less airtime today. So Mr. Sen, over to you without any further ado.
Thank you, Aditya. Welcome, Rajiv, and namaskar to everyone. A bit late in the day, but nonetheless, welcome to the show, and a big shout out to all the regular people over there. I have basically just two questions for you. The first one is to do, as we head into life 2.0, because after COVID, the life is going to be different. That's the way I look at it. So heading into life 2.0, what do you think, in your opinion, are the major skills that the learners of today, and I'll not call them students, I'll call them learners. So learners will be my age, as well as a learner who is 5 years old. So what are the skills the learners of today will need to focus on to compete? And they have to compete against the machines. We are back to the Terminator, and we are back to the Matrix, and we are back to all of those science fiction movies. But yeah, what are the skills that we need to focus on?
I would like to again use an example of learning from earlier days to now. In earlier days, let's say we were learning maths, so we were learning by road. So we used to read pahade, you know, we say 2 into 1 is 2, 2 into 2 is 4, and we kept on doing like that. When I went to college in Bits Pilani, we were allowed the use of calculators. And it was a revolution to me that I don't need to know anything, and I only need to have the concept. And they also said, because Bits curriculum was MIT program based, and there used to be take home assignments, there used to be open books, open book system or tests. So I would say that the most important thing is that to understand what you are reading and learning, and learn to apply that. If that is you, is your ability to process, absorb, and apply the information, whatever it be, whether it is math, science, physics, arts, and that is the most important thing, that because the world will keep changing, and the pace of change will continue to increase. And it is very, very important to learn very fast, grasp very fast, and start applying it very fast to make it into productive use. Second is that you have to unlearn the things that you learned earlier. So today, there is no relevance of my remembering those, 2 into 1 is 2, all those things.
Yeah, exactly.
And there's no relevance to me to say what I I used to run Sanskrit, Satavute, Tamtautan, all that, all that was. But whatever I need to know, I will be able to get it by browsing, searching, referring. Now, what do I do with it? Now, the second most important thing is that you have to learn to collaborate. You cannot do anything alone. Things are so sophisticated. Even today, having spent 40 years in technology, I am not able to program as well in Python as some of the young people. But I know what to program. I don't know the command or I don't know the syntax, but I have the concept. And if and they know the concept, but they don't know the command. So it's like you have to be able to kind of
complement each other.
Yeah, so you have to collaborate. Third is that with an ecosystem which makes your offering complete. So there may be somebody who's very good in selling. You have to have that person in your team, because whatever you are making has to be sold. Or you have to have somebody who's very good in technology. Then within technology also, when I did research in IT, for example, there are some people who are very good in finding defects in others, and they are not able to program. So we use them for testing. It's a useful thing, but we cannot use them for R&D because somebody else has to make it and they have to criticize it. So you have to have a collaborative system which completes your offering, and you have to, if you cannot have it as part of your team, you have to have it as part of your partnership or association with other companies. And I would say that these days there are many startups and there's a whole concept of co-working or co-sourcing. So that thing will start. Even employments may become multiple companies, the same person is working and getting paid based on what he delivers. So the second part is in terms of being able to have the ability to collaborate with a lot of people who may not be of your type as well, a very diverse population. They may not speak your language, they may not be of your culture, they may not be of your demography or social standing or anything. So you have to be able to collaborate with a Japanese, with a German, with a person from a village or a farmer. Or if you're making a farm product, if your farmer doesn't buy, you have to understand his needs. So this collaboration is very, very important. The third part is that you have to if this is good when you are leading something, but even if you are taking working in a job, you have to always think that how you can do it better tomorrow than what you did yesterday. Whatever you are doing, you have to be incremental in your productivity, I call it, in whatever you are doing, or knowledge or proficiency, which is a very, very important thing. So if, for example, if you're learning mathematics, you may know everything you have read in the book once, and anytime somebody asks, you will refer to it. But the point is that will you get 10 hours to solve the problem, or you have to solve it in half an hour? So, and we say, I take sports as an example because I have that background. Now, if I know all the rules of the game, how tennis is to be played, and which shot to pick for which stroke, or whatever, other game is to be played, cricket or something, that's the technical knowledge or technical know-how. Now, to a person to really play, he has to be proficient. He has to make split-second decisions, choose his shot, have his body coordinate the stroke, and actually deliver the stroke in time. Otherwise, you are a theoretical person. You are a good commentator. You are not a player. So there is a place for a good commentator. There's a place for a good coach, and there's a place for a player. A player may not have that much of a technical knowledge as a coach, for example, and a commentator may have a lot of technical knowledge and can criticize or can interestingly tell a story about what is happening. So telling a story is also a very important skill. So you have to be a multifarious person and build these skill sets yourself, or have an ecosystem or collaboration. And you have to focus on proficiency. Now, proficiency has speed and it has accuracy, and it has an incremental improvement required for tomorrow to what you did yesterday. You may think of it as your experience of doing it, or you may use some tools. If you are doing some work, you can build some tools to help you make it. It's like, even in, if I'm, you know, cooking, because I lived alone for many years as a bachelor, I also had to cook my own food. So I would maybe make some masala and keep it and then use it again and again, rather than making the masala every day. So you have to have some tools with you and think of what tools will help you improve. And this is what has happened. I mean, from a simple hull which was being used in farming, to now you have combined harvesters and who do everything from every aspect of the farming thing with all the equipment that you have. So your equipment and tools have to become more sophisticated, either logical or physical, and you have to think of, and those tools need not be made by you. You can purchase them, which also will come with your collaboration and knowledge. And I would also say that if you do not know what you want to be, then try a few things and then decide whether you want to pursue or you want to change. And changing is also okay. That is, a failure is okay. So I played table tennis, then I said that's not good, I may not do very much. So I played cricket, and also that was not very good. Then I did engineering, and then I wanted to do electronics, and then I ended up in doing software. And now, so it is not that you have to do only one thing. You have to keep changing based on your taste and where you think all these four or five traits and skills that I'm talking about, where they give you the maximum benefit in your way of work. And then, of course, not to you know, you have to be very ethical, you have to be very social, and, you know, in your way, and you know, all of that, you know, those skills are also very, very important, and you know, you have to learn. So there's much more to learn and than what it was in my days as well.
Excellent. So if I may summarize, let me try to summarize what you said. So the first skill that you talked about is learning, and how quickly we can learn new things and add up to it. So we could say that is the rate of learning. And you talked about the rate of change, because change is happening very fast. So I suppose we have to be ahead of the rate of change in our learning to be able to adapt to it quicker. So the first one is how quickly we can learn. Call it the rate of learning, or it's something like COVID is multiplying or doubling every 4 days or 10 days. So how quickly can we double our learning? That's an analogy. The second thing that you talked about, a skill, is collaboration within an ecosystem. So where we find people where we can collaborate with in an ecosystem to come up and actually achieve a certain outcome. So I think that's the second thing that you talked about. The third thing that you talked about is being proficient at whatever we do, whether it be a game, a sport, or whatever we are working on, or whatever we are learning, we become highly proficient in that. What we say that we become, we develop, you know, we become acknowledged as being good at it.
Yeah.
The fourth thing that you talked about is, I think that's very important, is you said it's okay to fail. And I love the way you said it. You know, you said it, hey, it's okay to fail. And I think that's there's a lovely way behind the words were said by you. Because what I have noticed is most of the people are scared to fail. And I think people like you and me, we can tell them, guys, hello, it's okay to fail. Because as we all know, that success cannot be built on success. Success can only be built on failures. It's as simple as that. And the fifth skill you talked about is ethics. And to have and develop ethics within ourselves and how we interact with the society and relationships. Would I be right in summing it up that way?
Yes, certainly. And I'd like to also add that the learning can also be collaborative. So we used to do group studies. So some people will, you know, read one chapter, then they'll explain to everybody. And that way, the whole group could learn much more than if we individually had to learn all chapters, right? So there are ways of collaboration, I think, gives much more, as long as you're honestly doing it with ethics, with you have a value system. And so there are many ways, and the pace of learning of everybody is very different. The style of learning is very different. So use the pace and style that agrees with you. Some people learn by reading. Some people learn by watching. Some people learn by doing. So whatever works for you, you have to adapt that method that works for you. And proficiency, again, comes with practice and you know, the right amount of effort and that is put into, you know, trying to solve a plethora of those problems.
Excellent.
Mr. So Sen,
folks. Yeah, Samar.
Yeah, one thing about what you said, many people fear failure. So quotation yaad aaya tha ek, as always. But then I guess this quotation has more to do with dating, but I guess this applies to everything in life. You miss 100% of the shots you don't take.
Yeah.
You're absolutely right.
Okay, back to you.
So folks, you have it there. The five skills which are perhaps required in the future of life 2.0. And mind you, for the people who are wondering what AI and ML is going to do, of the five skills, only the learning is something that the AI or ML can do. The other four, I don't think there's any way the machine or artificial intelligence can do. So guys, we're outplaying them 4-1. So no issues over there. We have it. Now that brings me to the last question that I have. And Rajiv, it is said that we never forget our first love.
Our first?
Love.
Okay.
This is from Samarth. He talked about dating. So we never do forget our first love. And over the last 1 hour, I could very clearly see and observe that you had not forgotten your first love. So could you tell us something more about your first love, which is sports?
Yeah, so what I did was, I played at the national level in the school boys cricket. So I switched sub-juniors, which is 7th to 9th. Was sub-junior, so table tennis. And when I joined cricket, we had a very reputable coach, which came as a PT teacher in our school, and he was a Ranji Trophy player. So he excited everybody into cricket, and I also gave up tennis and played cricket, because your wrist movement is very different in table tennis than it is in cricket as a technical part of it. And I was doing very well, played the North Zone and went and played in Bombay, I think, et cetera, et cetera. And then the board exams were in 11th. And there was a regret in my coach and perhaps in my friends that, because I was pretty good at it. So we had a team, national team or a regional team, and they were all looking forward to that. I played some hot weather tournaments and Ranji tournaments. I used to bat at that time. So when I went into Bits Pilani, I played all 5 years. From the first year, I was in the Pilani team. But the Pilani team was, like any engineering college, a very studious team. So not at the same level. So I did that. Then I joined TCS. I played for the TCS team. And then in HCL, I did not get much opportunity to play. By that time also, I had specs and I have a dual vision. So the ball has to go through four views, first from the without the specs, then the which are the short-sighted specs, and then the D, which is at the bottom. So the line breaks three times, so I can't see the ball straight. But that dump was not forgotten. So when I retired from HCL, there was this company called Fungage, which was introduced by my BITS classmate, who has been an ex-CEO in Philips. He also retired and he was an investor in startups. And he said, why don't you invest in startups? And since you have been a cricketer, why don't you invest in this company which is focused on cricket, bringing technology to cricket? So I got very excited. And this Fungage, their philosophy was that when you go for trials, I mean, when the people have become famous, then everybody knows them. But till you become famous as a cricketer, nobody knows you, and you don't know what you are doing right or wrong. You join some academies. If you go to a school, and you will know that whatever courses you did from class 1, 2, 3, 4, all the academic record is there. There's no sporting record of you in any school. If you go to a school and say, okay, how many students play basketball, how many play tennis, what positions they play, what is their score and what is their performance? Nothing. So they have an annual day and they give prizes and they give certificates and that's it. Right? Now, we said that we will bring technology. So we created a system where you could, and this Fungage, anybody can sign into that application. It's available on iPhone or Android, or even you just need an email ID and a password. So we tried to create a sports portal, which is specialized on sports. Just like you have Facebook is for social, LinkedIn is for professional, there's no sports dedicated.
There's no sports portal, yeah, that's right.
So that's the Fungage, which would then do some...
Fungage, is it?
F-U-N-N-G-A-G-E. It's fun, engage, engage in fun.
So Aditya, can you just send it out for the audience?
Yeah, F-U-N-N-G-A-G-E.
Sure, guys. So I'll comment that in the comment section. So anyone who's watching and is interested to check it out, please do.
So the concept was that you can record your videos of your playing or net practice or anything. And the videos will get analyzed by coaches and you will be rated. So they do trials, just like Indian Idol goes selecting for people singing. And they do hundreds and thousands of trials in all the cities. So the Fungage also did hundreds and thousands of trials in all the cities. And they said children from age 12 to 14, 14 to 16, 16 to 21, come and do a trial. Boys and girls, and we will record your trial, whether you're bowler, batsman, wicketkeeper, and we will analyze that trial. And they had hired about 15 national level coaches who would say whether your action was right, your speed is right, accuracy is right, your bowling length is right, whether you chose the right stroke and whether your footwork is right, your stance, all kinds of things, your grip. And they would select some top 500 and give them a three-day actual coaching and then send the 15 people to US, to England or to Australia and bring up the system. Just like American Indian Idol, you get to cut a record if you are in the finalist. But he did it for sports. So that is the professional part of every year it happens. Then there was a part which is informal part that you can play cricket tournaments. You can have a colony tournament or a house tournament and you can record your score. And the scoring app is also on the So you can say one run scored or boundary scored, etc. So everything is on the technology. And you can now compare the performance of one against the other, this region, and then you can say, okay, the left-arm spin bowler and your performance, all the Hyderabad left-arm spin bowlers, what are the scores, you can compare them. And when you go for trials, when you go for sports quota in colleges, for example, I got admission in St. Stephen's College's cricket quota, and I didn't take that. they will take those professionals. You have to appear for trials. So if you are whatever you are, and if you came for national cricket trial in Ferozshah Kotla, on a day there will be 2,000 candidates coming for trials, and the coach may miss you what you did. You know, he may be having a tea while you were doing your trial or something. And so it's a lot of, and there's a lot of subjectiveness, and there's only one coach who looks at you. Here you can actually, there's a record of what you did, there's a record of your performance of every game, there's a comparison, you can record your video, you can post pictures, you can invite your friends and family, and it's like a whole kind of record of sporting history. If you want to take career as a sports, then you can know that where you stand in this position, in this sport, in this, and then you can improve yourself. Your defects are known, what you have to work on. You can go back to your academy. So they also gave an academy, cricket academy administrating system, where they can collect the fees. The parents know what the children are doing, how they are performing, how they are versus other. There's a report card for you. Things like that. So it was quite interesting. But I have exited that company after initial investment. So, and the company is off to, Gautam Gambhir is the mascot of that. So he was, in fact, he was also very impressed with this, because he said when he joined cricket, it was not earning very much money. And to play matches, they used to go and take trains, and they would sleep on platforms. Some of his interviews are on the Fungage platform. It'll be very interesting to hear. And how the sports people were treated. So if till you are an established player, you have to live on your own means, and you have to live very frugally. You have no money for sports kits, things like that. So we are through this Fungage sponsorships and enrollments and things like that. We are trying to give scholarships to people that showed promise and things like that. So that is still my interest, but now I am more focused on my own company. It's a startup, but sports remains a challenge. Very, very exciting for me to apply technology in sports.
So there you have it, folks. Cricket's loss is technology's gain. And for all you know, if Rajiv had pursued his scholarship with St. Stephen's, we might have Rajiv Sodhi as part of Kapil's Devils in the 1983 squad. With that, I hand over to Samant to wrap it up.
Great, bahut hi interesting and inspiring story tha, you know, to hear about your journey. And वैसे आज दो quotation है to end on. Firstly, एक तो like taking from your one very short line, I don't think आपने भी सोचा था कि देखो लेकिन we have the info. आई थिंक इससे मैंने एक एजुकेशन रिलेटेड कोट प्रोड्यूस कर दिया था. सो इट गोज, वी हैव द लॉक, वी हैव द की, लेट्स टीच अ किड्स हाउ टू ओपन इट. वी हैव द इन्फो, वी हैव द टूल्स, लेट्स टीच देम हाउ टू अप्लाई इट. ग्रेट. एंड आपका कोटेशन, एज यू लाइक स्पेसिफिकली सेड इट, एंड दिस आई वुड एक्चुअली वॉन्ट टू एंड ऑन, थिंग्स आर चेंजिंग एवरी डे, अनलर्न, रीलर्न एंड कीप अपडेटिंग योर सेल्फ. With that being said, thank you so much, guys, the audience, for your questions, comments, and insights. Aditya and Mr. Sen, thank you for your questions, comments, and insights as well. And of course, Rajivji, thank you so much for taking time to speak with us. And thank you for coming to our podcast. Bahut kuch seekhne ko mila, and we gained some new perspective about, you know, the future of facial recognition and machine learning and AI.
And cricket.
And cricket, yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. It was very nice interacting with you, and I wish all the students and teachers and parents a very bright future.
Great. Thank you so much, sir. So guys, stay home, wash your hands, stay safe. We'll see you tomorrow same time at 6 p.m. with another guest. कल थोड़ा इंटरेस्टिंग होने वाला है. आई एम गिविंग यू अ डिस्क्लेमर क्योंकि कल का एक्चुअली इंटरेस्टिंग है. सो आई होप एवरीबॉडी कम्स इन टुमारो. लाइक एंड फॉलो आवर फेसबुक पेज एंड टर्न ऑन पोस्ट नोटिफिकेशंस टू गेट नोटिफाइड व्हेन वी डू गो लाइव. टेक केयर नाउ. बाय बाय.
थैंक यू
सर.